We light the candle. This morning, as we gather for worship, we light this candle in the name of justice, in the name of love, in the name of the Christ. We come to hear the stories of other people in a world long ago. We come to hear the stories that are also about us today, in this place. God, give us ears to listen, eyes to see, and hearts to accept. Good morning, everyone. I am the Reverend Carrie Perry, and I am a minister here at Lakefield and Young's Point United Church, and I welcome you to this time of worship with us online, as we have been doing for quite some time now. Many of you maybe are getting tired of the inability to gather together as the body of Christ. And yet we know that where two or three are gathered, the Spirit is with us and among us, and that happens virtually too. And so we give thanks to God, and we continue with our worship, singing together More Voices number 144, Like a Healing Stream. You split rocks open in the wilderness. You called forth water to pour from the fissures, to quench your people's thirst, to calm your people's complaints, to teach us how to trust. You split rocks open in the wilderness. You split rocks open in my heart. You called living water from there, too, to change your people's path, to fuel your people's journeys, to teach us how to believe. You are splitting rocks open in our communities. You are calling forth the rush of our voices, to flush out your people's complacency, to bubble up your people's creativity, to teach us how to act out in faith again. You are splitting and pouring and helping and and churning. You are rumbling and turning and raining and changing, and we are trying to follow along, not knowing, and yes, complaining. And you? You don't give up. So go ahead. We're here. Listening, learning, breaking, trying for you. Amen.
Good morning. Today's Old Testament lesson is from Exodus chapter 17, verses 1 to 7. At the Lord's command, the whole community of Israel left the wilderness of Sin and moved from place to place. Eventually, they camped at Rephidim, but there was no water there for the people to drink. So once more, the people complained against Moses. "Give us water to drink," they demanded. "Quiet," Moses replied. "Why are you complaining against me? And why are you testing the Lord?" But tormented by thirst, they continued to argue with Moses. "Why did you bring us out of Egypt? Are you trying to kill us, our children, and our livestock with thirst?" Then Moses cried out to the Lord, "What should I do with these people? They are ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Walk out in front of the people. Take your staff, the one you used when you struck the water of the Nile, and call some of the elders of Israel to join you. I will stand before you on the rock of Mount Sinai. Strike the rock, and water will come gushing out. Then the people will be able to drink." So Moses struck the rock, as he was told, and water gushed out as the elders looked on. Moses named the place Massah, which means test, and Meribah, which means arguing, because the people of Israel argued with Moses and tested the Lord by saying, "Is the Lord here with us or not?" Our New Testament lesson today comes from Matthew chapter 21, verses 23 to 32. The authority of Jesus is questioned. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and elders of the people came to him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked. "And who gave you the authority?" Jesus replied, "I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or of human origin?" They discussed it among themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the people, for they all hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then he said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things." The parable of the two sons. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, "Son, go and work today in the vineyard." "I will not," he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, "I will, sir," but he did not go. Which of these two did what the father wanted? "The first," they answered. Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him." This is the word of the Lord.
Moving in my heart, I Upon the mountain my Lord spoke, out of his mouth came fire and smoke, Jordan River chilling cold, chill the body but not the soul. Oh, every time runs to heaven and runs right back. Oh, every time I feel the spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Every time I feel the spirit
And so may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. By whose authority? That's the question that has been bouncing around in my head all week. By whose authority? It's the question of the Pharisees in this passage from Matthew, and it's directed to Jesus, who, in their opinion, doesn't have it. Authority, that is. The word authority is derived from the Latin word auctoritas, and the English word author comes from this same Latin noun. Auctoritas denotes that one is an authority and can therefore speak or reliably write on certain matters. Authority is variously interpreted as the power to give orders to people, the power to influence or command thought, opinion, or behavior, the power or right to direct or control someone or something. And Jesus? He doesn't have it. Not in the eyes of the Pharisees and the other leaders of the time, anyway. He is not, in the view of the Pharisees, someone like Caesar, appointed, no, endowed by God with authority. He is not, as far as we know, educated. It's unlikely that the son of a refugee carpenter would ever have had the means of opportunity to be educated in the same way that a Pharisee would have been, or that they would deem worthy. He is not of the house of Aaron, the Jewish tribe given authority over the temple by Moses when the Ten Commandments came down. He isn't a representative of Rome. He's not a soldier whose task it is to keep order. He is, in their eyes, nothing and nobody. He's a vagrant preacher, luring hordes of people, the wrong kinds of people, to him and teaching them. Teaching them about an upside-down kingdom where the last will be first and the first will be last. And the people, all those wrong people, they're buying into it. They're investing in it, believing in it. And there is nothing more dangerous than a horde of people with something to believe in. And the Pharisees, and the governor, and the other leaders of the time, they're afraid. And it's fear that drives their question, fear of the power that Jesus has, fear of a loss of their own power, fear of what's coming to pass. You see, if Jesus has the authority to do these things, to heal and to curse, to teach and to promise, then what of them and what of their authority? When someone asks a question like this, they're not really looking for an answer. They already believe that they have the answer. They ask it believing that you don't have the authority to do whatever it is that you're doing, and they seek to use their own authority to stop you from doing it. Authority. The power to give orders to people. The power to influence or command thought, opinion, or behavior. The power to direct or control someone or something. It's an interesting thing to ponder authority in the world that we find ourselves in the time of a pandemic, yes, but not just in the time of a pandemic where we have anti-maskers protesting the authority of Premier Ford, when we have those relying on the autonomy of science and politicians to keep us safe, to get us out of this, to remember the economy and personal freedom and the value of all lives. Yes, it's interesting to ponder authority in this specific time and place, but I'm thinking more broadly about authority. Authority in the 2000s, in North America, in Canada. And I wonder and I ponder just who it is that has the power to give orders, to influence or command opinion or behavior, to direct or control someone or something. I believe that Jesus calls us to consistently challenge notions of authority, to welcome the least and last, and be prepared when we find ourselves asking, like the Pharisee, who said you could do that? I'm probably about to offend some of you. That's okay. We can talk about that over tea or across a Zoom channel if you feel so inclined. By whose authority are children ripped out of the arms of their fathers and mothers and placed in cages when they dare to cross a geographical boundary? It sure isn't in the name of love. By whose authority are Indigenous women and girls the victims of persistent and deliberate human and Indigenous rights violations, abuses, and even murder? For so long, no one said anything. No one did anything. It sure isn't in the name of love. By whose authority are Black men and women systematically targeted for demise? Why do they get pulled over, receive harsher judicial sentences, or fear doing ordinary things like going shopping or jogging or calling for help when they need it and end up crying out, "I can't breathe"? It sure isn't in the name of love. By whose authority does the market and economy rule the world and persistent economic inequities bring life to a few and hardship, challenge, and even death to so many more? Our civil participation and our routines of spending, consuming, and discarding the things that we use each day, as well as permitting profit-taking at the expense of full-time, adequately paid, benefit-endowed work that gives dignity and hope to people, destroys lives of individuals and families. It sure isn't in the name of love. By whose authority does the earth continue to be ravaged? Climate change is the defining crisis of our time. Rising temperatures are fueling environmental degradation, natural disasters, weather extremes, food and water insecurity, economic disruption, conflict, and even terrorism. Sea levels are rising, the Arctic is melting, coral reefs are dying, oceans are acidifying, forests are burning. It is clear that business as usual is not good enough. And it sure isn't in the name of love. By whose authority? Yes, this question has been bouncing around in my head and my heart this week, and another similar to it. Who are we in the face of these things? Will we face the questions and feel the trap like the Pharisees did? Will we hem and haw and still our tongues because we are too afraid to speak the truth that we know? There is racism in this country, systemic racism. The events of this past summer reveal that in a powerful way. What are we doing about it? If someone were to ask what the church is doing about it, what this church is doing about it, we cannot answer, we don't know. There is the bedeviling problem of gender discrimination and violence in this country, particularly for racialized women, but also for all women, for your mother, your partner, your daughter, your minister. What are we doing about it? If someone were to ask what the church is doing about it, what this church is doing about it, we cannot answer. We don't know. Young people the world over are crying for us to do something about climate change so as to protect the world that they are even now living in and will inherit from us. What are we doing about it? If someone were to ask what the church is doing, what this church is doing about it, we cannot answer. We don't know. We must act, for our authority commands us to do so. Our authority shows us how. Our authority calls and equips us. For our authority is love. Our authority is justice. Our authority is hope and faith and promise. But my friends, the greatest of these is still love. And in this kingdom, this place of unquestioning welcome, of unrelenting grace, of unimaginable love, you do not need anyone's authority to belong. Thanks be to God. Amen. May the simple gifts we offer this day become a fountain of blessing to others, bringing them hope, healing, joy, and peace. Amen. This morning, as we offer our prayers, I'm going to leave an extended time of silence for you to offer your own words, to reach out to the holy in whatever way seems best to you, to allow your mind and your bodies to quiet so the deepest groanings of our spirits can be heard. And so join with me in prayer. Holy God, we seek your presence this day. We seek your wisdom, we seek your guidance, we seek your love, and we seek your justice in these people and in these places in our time. holy God. For the people and places we have named in the quietness of our own space, in the quietness of our own hearts, we ask for your abiding presence. We ask for your healing, for your life, and your love. We ask these things in the name of the one who taught us to say so long ago, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Become a river of love through the world. Go forth to share Christ's grace. Become a fountain flowing in the barren places. Go forth to share the community of the Spirit. Become a pool of peace where all may be refreshed. Go in peace. Amen.